Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Lincoln Center and to the Temenos Academy. And our warm thanks, as always, to Alan Parker and his staff for their generous hospitality here. So it's a great pleasure to welcome John Matthews once again to Temenos. John is a widely known author, filmmaker, and teacher in the field of Celtic, traditional, and Arthurian studies. He's the author of more than 100 books on myth, fairy, the Arthurian legends, and Grail studies. And with Caitlin Matthews, he's a well-known authority in particular on Arthurian matters. And I'm happy to say that John and I have recently collaborated on an edition of the Arthurian poems of Charles Williams, which I hope will be available one of these days. But John's interests range very widely. His recent books include a highly successful book on pirates, as well as The Mystery of Spring-Heeled Jack, whose terrifying figure I remember from my own childhood in Liverpool, where he was one of the local folk legends, and more relevant to tonight's topic, Robin Hood, Green Lord of the Wildwood, which examines the mythical roots of the Robin Hood legend. But tonight, John is contributing to our series of lectures on the Inklings, and it's a great pleasure to welcome him here this evening to speak on Tolkien, the Green Man, and the mythology of England. John Matthews.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Greville. Hello, everybody. I hope my voice holds up because it's a bit croaky at the moment, but I've been well provided with strepsils, so hope for the best anyway. Well, like many others, probably many of you here in this room, I first read The Lord of the Rings when I was in my teens. I also wrote a fan letter to Professor Tolkien. It was a 10-page missive, I remember. It went into great detail about how much I liked and loved his treatment of the myths. And I also mentioned the fact that I'd started writing a huge Arthurian novel, still unfinished, I'm afraid, but still in progress. And I added in passing how much I admired the writings of his colleague Charles Williams. I didn't expect a response, but I did get one, in which Tolkien expressed the fact that he was not a great lover of the Arthurian romance and that he did not like what he called Charles Williams' Arthurianisms. Despite this, he enclosed a letter, with his letter, a poem called The Lay of Eötru and Itrún, which has just been published, which makes reference to the great Arthurian forest of Broceliande, which just happened to be the title of my novel, and which evokes in a series of refrains the forests and woodlands of Arthur's Britain. For example, in Britain's land beyond the seas, the wind blows ever through the trees. Or, in Britain, ways are wild and long, and woods are dark with danger strong, and sound of sea is in the leaves, and wonder walks the forest eaves. Later on, I heard about Tolkien's widely publicized statement that he had written The Lord of the Rings to provide a mythology for England, and that he regarded the Arthurian legends as too French. By this time, I'd spent several years studying Arthurian literature and myth, and I know that I reacted very strongly and adversely to this, because I knew, as Tolkien must, that the foundation for most of the Arthurian stories was actually Celtic, and came not from French, but from Celtic sources. And here, perhaps, lies the real problem Professor Tolkien had with Arthurian literature in general, that its roots were Celtic, while he loved all things Saxon. Given this, it perhaps would have been expecting too much for anyone to approve of a literature written by those who had been once historic enemies. I think since then, every time I've read The Lord of the Rings, and that's quite a few times over the years, I never really stopped looking for Arthurian parallels. I stand with another great British writer, John Masefield, who, like Tolkien, lived in Oxford and wrote of the Arthurian legends shortly before his death, Has not the time come for a remaking and a reissue of the Epic of Arthur by a body of good scholars and writers? Is not the time ripe for an authorized version using old poems and fables little used by or unknown to Malory? It is our English epic. We ought to make more use of it than we do. Tolkien did not, nor would he have wished, I think, to do any such thing. But he embedded so many Arthurian echoes in his books that he did go some way towards it. I could say a lot about Arthurian references in Tolkien, including the Merlin-like character of Gandalf, Aragorn as Arthur, and so on, not to mention the very strong parallels between the character and situation of King Theoden and the Wounded King of the Grail romances. Both are failing physically and as kings, and both have those who speak and act for them. I could also make out perhaps a reasonable case for a comparison between the One Ring and the Grail in Arthurian tradition. But instead of any of these, I want to concentrate on a particular theme and on the characters that represent this in Tolkien's work. Specifically, this has to do with the treatment of nature, which was clearly sacred to him in a very special way, not unlike the way it was understood by the pagans of the ancient world. Despite Tolkien's dismissal, or should one perhaps say distrust, of Arthurian literature, he had himself begun a long poem, The Fall of Arthur, which was only published last year, in which he once again evoked the forest, Mirkwood, familiar to us from The Lord of the Rings. Thus at last they came to Mirkwood's margin under mountain shadows. Waste was behind them, walls before them, on the houseless hills, ever higher mounting, vast and vanquished, lay the veiled forest. Dark and dreary were the deep valleys, where limbs gigantic of lowering trees in endless aisles were arched o'er rivers, flowing down far from fells of ice. Wolves were howling on the wood's border. Cold blew the wind, keen and wintry, in rising wrath from the rolling forest among roaring leaves. Wonderful stuff. At around the same time that he wrote this, he was working on the editing of one of the most famous English Arthurian romances, an edition which is still widely used to this day. I refer, of course, to his edition prepared with Professor E.V. Gordon of the medieval poem Sir Gawain and the Green Knight. We also have Tolkien's own translation of this, which was published posthumously. Though he refused to speak of them in any detail, Tolkien acknowledged in the introduction to the poem the presence of ancient rituals, pagan divinities of the sun, fertility, and of the dark and the underworld in the most wholly lost antiquity of the north and of these western isles. But were they really lost, either in reality or in Tolkien's mind? I think not. It struck me long since that there were some very interesting parallels between one of the characters in this poem and one of the leading characters in The Lord of the Rings. But let me begin, for the benefit of those who are not familiar with it, with a brief summary of the poem. Sir Gawain and the Green Knight was written by an anonymous author living in the Midlands, somewhere around 1400. It tells the story of what happens one Christmas at Camelot when Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table are sitting down to supper. Just as they are about to eat, thunder rolls and lightning flashes, announcing the appearance of a strange figure that confronts the king and his men, announcing that he is the Green Knight. He is indeed a most terrifying being. His skin and hair and his enormous bushy beard are green, as is his horse, his armor, and everything about him, except for his eyes, which are red. Over his shoulder he carries a huge axe, and in his other hand a club of green holly. The Green Knight challenges Arthur and his men, addressing them in slighting tones and suggesting they play a Christmas game with him, assuming that they have the courage to do so. The nature of this game is that he will allow any man there to strike a blow with his great green axe, on the understanding that they will afterwards accept a return blow. Understandably, perhaps, Arthur hesitates before accepting this curious challenge, and in that moment his nephew, Sir Gawain, leaps up and offers to undertake the challenge on his behalf. The scene proceeds as follows. The Green Knight dismounts from his horse, hands his axe to Gawain, who raises it and strikes off the Green Knight's head. However, instead of falling, the body of the Green Knight marches across the hall, picks up the severed head and holds it aloft, at which point the lips move and announce that he will expect Sir Gawain in 1 year's time at the Green Chapel, where he will receive his return blow. The Green Knight then mounts his horse and, still carrying the grisly severed head, departs from the hall. Well, a year passes and Gawain sets out in search of the Green Chapel. Within a few days of the allotted time, as it takes him a whole year to traverse Britain, and particularly in the winter days, he arrives at a castle and is made welcome by the rough and boisterous Lord Bursilac and his beautiful wife. When he reveals that he is searching for the Green Chapel, Gawain is told that it lies close by and that Sir Bursilac will provide a guide to show him the way. Meanwhile, he insists that Gawain remains at the castle to rest and be entertained. During the next 3 days, we are treated to a detailed account of Gawain's stay at the castle. Each morning, Sir Bursilac announces that he will go hunting and offers to exchange any prize that he acquires with his guest. And each day, once the lord has gone, Gawain is visited in his room by Lady Bursilac, who attempts to seduce him. In each case, Gawain is mindful of his knightly honor and refuses her, accepting only a kiss on the first night, 2 kisses on the second night. And each night when Bursilac returns with the spoils of the hunt, he demands an exchange with Gawain. What did you win from the day? And of course, Gawain is only able to offer a chaste, manly kiss by way of answer. On the last night before Gawain is about to go off in search of the Green Chapel, and fearful for his life, Gawain accepts one gift from the lady, a talisman that she promises him will prevent any harm from happening to him. It's a green sash that if he wears it, he will not be harmed in any battle. So, come the following morning, Green Knight appears at the castle of the chapel. Gawain kneels to receive the blow. Down comes the axe twice, and each time it stops just short of his neck. Then the third time, it just nicks the side of his neck so that a little blood is drawn, but nothing more. Angrily now, Gawain leaps up and demands satisfaction because this is a slur to his knightly honor. He's had the courage to come there to await the blow. It's not happening. At which point, the Green Knight amazingly declares himself to be Sir Bursilac, who's been enchanted by the goddess Morgan, an old woman who lives in the house in the castle, hidden most of the time, and who had cast the spell of enchantment over Gawain so that he can, over Bursilac, so that he can go and challenge Arthur's men. Gawain accepts this and decides that when he gets back to Arthur's court, he's going to wear the green sash forever as a token of how he almost failed, but didn't quite. Now, this game of the Green Knight is an age-old one, well attested in mythologies around the world. The pattern is always the same thing. The being, be it god or spirit or hero, offers his lifeblood for the sake of the people in return for their own courage and self-sacrifice. The exchange is at the heart of the Green Knight stories, as it is at the heart of the Christian story, as Tolkien well knew. As the guardian of the natural world, the Green Knight challenges people to acknowledge his yearly sacrifice by offering a willing service to all of creation. Gawain does not overcome the Green Knight, but submits to a greener and greater strength than his own. And since Gawain has long been recognized as a solar hero, it's quite interesting that a hero imbued with the powers of the sun gives way to the powers of the earth. Well, so much for the story of this remarkable poem, which seamlessly bends Christian and pagan beliefs. I'd like to quote 2 passages from Professor Tolkien's own translation. The first is a description of the boisterous Sir Bursilac, and the second describes the friendship and hospitality he offered to the knight. Gawain gazed at the good man who had greeted him kindly, and he thought, bold and big was the baron of the castle, very large and long, and his life at the prime. Broad and bright was his beard, and all beaver-hued, stern, strong in his stance upon stalwart legs. His face fell as fire, and frank in his speech, and well it suited him, in sooth, as it seemed to the knight, a lordship to lead untroubled over lieges trusty. This is followed by the hospitality. They took him in between them, and talking, they led him to a fireside in a fair room, and first of all called for spices, which men sped without sparing to bring them, and ever wine therewith well to their liking. The Lord, for their delight, leapt up and full often, many times merry games being minded to make. His hood he doffed, and on high he hung it on a spear, and offered it as an honour for any to win, who the most fun could devise at the Christmas feast. And I shall try, by my troth, to contend with the best ere I forfeit this hood, with the help of my friends. Thus, with laughter and jollity, the Lord made his jests to gladden Sir Gawain with games that night. And I think that anyone here who is familiar with Lord of the Rings may already guess where I'm going with this. But here is a quotation from the Lord of the Rings. There was another burst of song, and suddenly, hopping and dancing along the path, there appeared above the reeds an old battered hat with a tall crown and a long blue feather stuck in the band. With another hop and a bound, there came into view a man, or so it seemed. At any rate, he was too large and heavy for a hobbit, if not quite tall enough for one of the big people, though he made noise enough for one, stumping along with great yellow boots on his thick legs, and charging grass and rushes like a cow going down to drink. He had a blue coat and a long brown beard. His eyes were blue and bright, and his face as red as a ripe apple, but creased into 100 wrinkles of laughter. In his hands he carried a large leaf, as on a tray a small pile of white water lilies. This is, of course, a description of the redoubtable Tom Bombadil, one of Tolkien's most unforgettable characters. He is described as the eldest, the oldest of the old, the master of wood, water, and hill, and is represented as a spirit so powerful, so potent, and so ancient that not even the all-powerful ring can affect him. His hospitality to the hobbits on their journey reflects the hospitality of Bersalac to Gawain, also setting out on a life-or-death journey. Of course, I'm not saying that Tom Bombadil is the Green Knight, merely that the one may have influenced the other. Though they are not alike in appearance, they are alike in character. Tolkien himself, in various letters, admitted that he was reluctant to explain Bombadil and even professed not to fully understand him. But there's more to it than this. Bombadil, along with the Ents, is very clearly an embodiment of the natural world, which Tolkien represented as being in a perilous state. In this alone, Tom resembles the Green Knight, but the Green Knight, as perhaps is Old Tom, is an aspect of one of the most ancient and potent symbols of the natural world that mankind has ever produced. You can find this character represented in carved heads, found in Middle Eastern temples, in some of the most characteristic imagery of the classical world, and throughout the folklore traditions of Europe, and in the figure of the Green Knight. But by far the most significant appearance of this figure is the extraordinary carvings found within the medieval cathedrals and churches of Europe. Known as foliate heads, these carvings represent humanoid faces that seem to be made from leaves, seem to be disgorging greenery from their mouths, eyes, nostrils, and ears. And they are found, generally speaking, hidden among the roof bosses or on the highest areas on the outside of these buildings. It's been pointed out that few of these heads would have been visible to the congregations worshipping below, and this has raised the question of why they were put there, and in addition, who put them where, there, and what they represented. The story of the Green Man is made up of many strands, each of which contributes to the whole. For some, he is an ancient symbol of nature and fertility, and can be seen to represent mankind's connection with the earth. To others, he is a symbol of wildness, of the untamed spirit that lives within each of us and reflects the wildness at the heart of nature. In our own time, the Green Man has become an official icon for the environmental movement, pointing the way in which we continue to interact with the world around us. He is also, I believe, very much present in Tolkien's great work. The idea of a green man as representative of the natural world probably dates back to the first agrarian peoples of the ancient world, who felt the power of nature and gave it a face and form. We have only to look at the way in which the greenness, if left to itself, thrusts through the earth, overcomes everything in its path, demolishes walls and buildings, and glories in its strength, to understand why a masculine image was chosen. There are green women, but they are rare. Certainly among the tribal peoples who inhabited the vast woodlands that once covered much of the European continent, the green man ruled supreme as a spirit of these woods, a representation in semi-human guise of the abiding life force of the trees. Both as an actual presence and as symbolic entities in their own right, these vast woodlands made a deep and lasting impression on the imagination of those who dwelt close to their shaded depths. Individual sacred trees featured in many cultures and often possessed the qualities of the deities to which they were dedicated. Though no truly ancient image of this kind has survived, we may imagine that certain trees would have been seen as representatives of the Green Man, or perhaps the Green Man of them, and many would have been, well, perhaps carved into his likeness. But even if this were not the case, the connection between trees and the sustaining of the world provided links with the energy of nature represented by the Green Man. For the Norse people, the entire world was founded on the roots and branches of the world tree Yggdrasil, while in ancient Ireland, the great yew, Iomugna, was considered a source of druidic and territorial power. In the Mediterranean world, the cult of the dying and rising god Attis, himself a type of green man, was represented by a pine tree, which was carried in procession during religious festivals. In a severely deforested world, it is hard to imagine just how dense our woodlands once were. Forests were places of awe and mystery, into whose depth few would venture during the day, although the resources of the woodshore were useful to those who lived nearby. In northwest Europe, these dense forests often contained groves of sacrifice out of spiritual mystery. From trees in the groves dedicated to the Norse cult of Odin, both human and animal offerings were hung, indicators of the powerful forces of the ancient forest gods. The oak groves of the Celtic world were the haunt of strange forest beings and awesome tree spirits, their mysteries known only to the Druids, whose knowledge and understanding of the natural world was second to none. Now, all of this may seem a long way away from Tolkien, but it's not. Tolkien's description of Fangorn and of its mysterious tree herds, the Ents, a name found in Norse myths, by the way, and not coined by Tolkien, were very clear. Let me quote you another passage. They found that they were looking at the most extraordinary face. It belonged to a large, man-like, almost troll-like figure, at least 14 feet high, very sturdy, with a tall head and hardly any neck. Whether it was clad in stuff like green and grey bark, or whether that was its hide, was difficult to say. At any rate, the arms, at a short distance from the trunk, were not wrinkled, but the lower part of the long face was covered with a sweeping grey beard, bushy, almost twiggy at the roots, thin and mossy at the ends. But at the moment, the hobbits noted little but the eyes. These deep eyes were now surveying them, slow and solemn, but very penetrating. They were brown, shot with a green light. I think a better description of the Green Man would be hard to find. There is a degree of wildness, a depth in Treebeard and the Ents which can be released, as we see in the destruction of Isengard. And this too is present in the many forms of the Green Man. You can see it in the leaf mask carvings discovered in the Middle Eastern cradle of civilization, which leads us neatly to the Sumerian epic of Gilgamesh, dating from 700 BC. where we encounter a figure who represents just such a power. Enkidu, a wild and primitive being whose great strength and passionate soul embodies the energy of nature itself. Jealous of his power, the gods condemn Enkidu to die, prompting his friend, the hero Gilgamesh, to undertake a journey to the other world in search of a cure for death itself, a plant called the Old Man Has Become a Young Man Again. Although Gilgamesh finds the plant, he loses it again to a serpent, which at once sloughs its skin in a symbolic image of rebirth. In the poems that make up the Gilgamesh epic, Enkidu represents an overflowing life force, wild and untamed. He stands out as one of the oldest representations of the potent energy of the Green Man that was to reappear later during the Middle Ages in the figure of the Wild Man, who represented a return to the idea of living closer to the natural world. Wild men and women and children were represented in the artwork of the time as actually being covered in leaves which grew on them rather than being worn. They lived wildly in the woods. They ate from whatever they could find, and they weren't very friendly. Though considered barely human, the wild men and women represented a return to nature long before Rousseau proposed it. In the classical world, we find references to older, wilder forces than the ordered deities of Mount Olympus. Just as among the Celtic peoples, every tree, stream, hill, and grove had its own dyad, nymph, and tutelary spirit. The god Pan, whose name means universal, was a major deity of nature. As the protector of the wild, he could appear anywhere in the natural world. Those who came across him at lonely, unfrequented places were said to be consumed with panic at the sight of him. This experience of solitude, of a numinous sense of wild, god-filled nature, is one seldom experienced in a world that has tamed so much of the earth. But Pan could not be tamed or controlled any more than Dionysus or his Roman equivalent Bacchus could be made to obey the desires of his followers. The wild green power of Dionysus, like that of Pan, overcame the ordered world of humanity in much the same way that plants penetrate concrete. His growths overwhelm man-made structure, and his ferment enters into the human body so that we can experience for ourselves the ecstatic life of plants. Both gods represent an energy that is an essential aspect of the Green Man. To my mind, the character of Treebeard in Tolkien's epic is a significant addition to this list of gods, goddesses, and heroes. I asked a question earlier, why was the Green Man almost hidden among the roof bosses and far up on the outer walls of the churches and cathedrals of Europe? During the Middle Ages, woodlands were managed and coppiced to provide cover for deer and sport for the nobility. Forests were administered by royally appointed foresters and wood wards and became forbidden to ordinary people. Excuse me. But the loss of the forests and the building of the great cathedrals happened at the same time. The early church fathers, perhaps with reason, were suspicious of the woodland and what went on there, as well as what inhabited them. This despite the fact that it was partly an acknowledgement of the importance of the ancient treescapes, that so much of the architecture of medieval churches was designed to make them look like stone forests. To see this, you only have to look at the writings of the 13th century theologian Honorius of Autun, who in his detailed description of the symbology of the church and every aspect of the Mass said that the pillars were trees and that beyond the pillars you could see the stars. So it's not really surprising to find the Green Man there. His presence was too deeply embedded in the consciousness of the ordinary people to be forgotten. I always like to think of the masons who carved those, you know, sitting up in the top of the church and carving these wonderful faces, many of which are leering or pulling faces or thumbing their noses down at the congregation below, who would not have been able to see them because there was no electric light. So, of course, wasn't until later that many people actually realized they were there. But other factors underlie these carvings. The dependency upon the harvest had not yet been replaced by modern methods of preservation and freezing. If the harvest failed, so did life. No one was exempt, lord or ordinary person. The gate cathedrals entailed the cutting down of prime trees to provide scaffolding for the huge stones to be raised. This enormous undertaking required its own harvest of men, skilled craftsmen who learned their trade through the respect of their materials, stone, iron, and wood. It was they who carved the foliate heads and placed them high above the heads of the worshippers. Like all men engaged in dangerous work, they needed their talismans, carving their protectors in places of honor in acknowledgement of their powers. Were they aware, perhaps, of the hubris of climbing higher than the tallest trees, even in the service of God's glory? Lest the woodland spirits be offended, their green images were set higher than the holy images upon the altar. Ideas and realizations of this kind passed into the folk life and customs of ordinary people, along with the distant memories of devotion to the power of nature. Scraps of lore and imagery became embroiled in dance, in folk plays, story, song, and legend, underpinning the traditions of a world that still acknowledged the presence of the green man, despite an increasing sense of separation from nature. But the story doesn't end there. The green man has continued to reappear throughout the ages, reflecting in a way he is represented in the forms he takes, the changing relationship of humanity with nature. And often, and not at all surprisingly, considering our constant attempts to subdue the earth to our needs, he comes as a challenger, seeming at times more than a little threatening. Yet beneath this fearsome aspect lies an unquenchable fountain of delight, which finds outlet in many ways, notably the exuberant festivals of May Day and Midsummer, which continue to be celebrated in our own time, and which become at times an all-out honoring of the green man in his many forms. Like many other gods of the ancient world, the green man is ever-present in the cycle of the growing year. He makes his youthful appearance amid the first green unfurling of spring, growing sturdily into the full panoply of summer manhood, before beginning his descent into the rich reds and browning tints of his autumn age. As the bare, withered branches of winter reveal the skeletal woods, he is still present in the evergreens of the forest. The green man is thus a constant companion throughout the year, and his presence is acknowledged as the many festivals that celebrate the turning of the seasons. From earlier times, rituals designed to ensure that the yearly cycle continued supported the ancient pattern of planting, growth, and harvest. At one time, sacrificial offerings, some human, were made to appease the gods of the natural world and ensure the health and fertility of the earth. In many parts of the world, especially throughout the Mediterranean, vegetation and harvest cults sprang up with their attendant mysteries of the dying and rising god. One of the most widespread stories focused on the sacrificed god king, sometimes called the King of the Wood or Rex Nemerensis, a man chosen to reign for a year, then killed, his slayer taking over his role for a further 12 months. This is once again going back to the original underlying story of Gawain and the Green Knight. A variation of this theme incorporated a ritualized battle between the king and his successor, now identified as Kings of Summer and Winter, for the possession of the Maiden of Spring. These three characters reappear in literature and folklore all over the world, and in each case, if we look closely, we can see the face of the green man and woman peering out from behind them. Nor do we have to look too far in Tolkien's work to see, in the figure of the elusive Goldberry, partner to Tom Bombadil, the Spring River Maiden. In a chair, on the far side of the room facing the outer door, sat a woman. Her long yellow hair rippled down her shoulders. Her gown was green, green as young reeds, shot with silver like beads of dew, and her belt was of gold, shaped like a chain of flag lilies, set with the pale blue eyes of forget-me-nots. About her feet, in wide vessels of green and brown earthenware, white water lilies were floating, so that she seemed to be enthroned in the midst of a pool of flowers. Another aspect of the spirit of nature and the wild woods, whose functioning is not unlike that of the green man, is the wild man. Descriptions of him abounding in medieval literature, where he's usually seen as a man who combines human, animal, and sometimes vegetative traits, usually currently with long hair of leaves and always fierce and ungovernable, a strange being, often shown carrying a club or even an uprooted tree with which they would lay about them at any sign of human approach. I can tell I dictated that last passage because it isn't typed up right. The medieval writers who described these creatures saw them as representatives of nature, as tamed, as being something rejected from human civilization. They acted as woodwards and the protectors of animals, like Enkidu in the Gilgamesh poems. They were untamed, speaking the instinctive language of nature with the ease of an animal. They were alternatively perceived as admirable or threatening, admirable for their ability to sustain themselves outside the civilized world, threatening because of the way they guarded their territory against the inroads of town and city. The green man himself may still be seen in this way. He can be either friendly or aggressive according to how humanity behaves towards the environment. Is this not the same untamed world of Tom Bombadil and his Goldberry, of the dark wards of Mirkwood, or the wild forests of Broceliande? In our own time, the green man has returned through a resurgence of interest in green living and increasing concerns for the survival of our natural habitat. The works of contemporary fantasists, such as the immensely popular Mythago Wood novels of Robert Holdstock, or the urban fantasies of Canadian writer Charles de Lint, reflect a growing interest in the story of the green man and what it stands for. And here, of course, we return to the works of Professor Tolkien. There is, for me anyway, no doubt at all that Treebeard, and to a lesser degree Tom Bombadil, have brought the presence of the green man into the lives of countless readers, while comic book heroes such as Green Lantern, Green Arrow, and Slane, and the popular TV series Robin of Sherwood have helped keep us aware of the character and purpose of the green man in some of his many guises. And of course, this would include Robin Hood, who is very much an aspect of the green man. The struggles and challenges offered by the green man draw us back to a realization of our own perilously eroded relationship with the environment, which Professor Tolkien recognized long before it was fashionable to do so. A desire to conquer the natural world, to rob it of its resources, to decimate its productivity in the name of progress and financial gain, has caused us to come perilously close to the destruction of the natural world, foreshadowed by the machine-like intent of Saruman. The return of the green man in our time as an unacknowledged icon of the ecological movement can be seen as only the latest chapter in an age-old story that begins in the shadowy forest world of early man and continues to this day in the ongoing struggle to save the green world from eventual extinction. Nature's wisdom is an oral tradition that we can all experience. It is to the greenwood that we look to provide the paper on which to record our own store of wisdom in book form. We still need the nurture of the green through the grains, nuts, and fruits that it provides. We cover our bodies with clothes derived from the wood pulp and fibers of the greenwood, colored by vegetable dyes. The power of herbs, plants, and trees restores us to health when we are sick. Truly, there is no end to our symbiotic connection with the green. Professor Tolkien would, I am sure, have endorsed this, for these things are embodied by the ancient myths of Britain before it was England. For me, this is made clear in almost every line of The Lord of the Rings, especially where he deals with the natural world. Tolkien is among the foremost writers of our times when it comes to describing the landscape through which his heroes and heroines pass. Let me leave you with just one example, which is as full of the unseen, but not, I think, unacknowledged presence of the myth of the Green Knight and the Green Man and his antecedents. Day was opening in the sky, and they saw that the mountains were now much further off, receding eastward in a long curve that was lost in the distance. Before them, as they turned west, gentle slopes ran down into dim hazes below. All about them were small woods of resinous trees, fir and cedar and cypress, and other kinds unknown in the Shire, with wide glades among them, and everywhere there was a wealth of sweet-smelling herbs and shrubs. Many great trees grew there, planted long ago, falling into unattended age amid riot of careless descendants, and groves and thickets there were of tamarisk and the pungent terebinth of olive and of bay, and there were junipers and myrtles and thymes that grew in bushes or with their woody stems creeping, stems mantled in deep tapestries of hidden stones. Sages of many kinds, putting forth blue flowers, or red, or pale green, and marjorams, and new sprouting parsleys, and many herbs of forms and scents beyond the garden lore of Sam. And many lily flowers nodded their half-opened heads in the grass, deep green grass, beside the pools where falling streams halted in cool hollows on their journey down to Anduin. Thank you.